enjoy your life. How many times the pastor said that to you? Enjoy your life. God has given you so many wonderful things. Language is just one of them for you to enjoy. It's not supposed to be all bad. We are on the fourth level of our, I don't do it like that. Why am I doing that now? Open. This is how I like it. Okay. Of our series, The Wisdom Pyramid. I hope you guys have been enjoying this series and getting a lot out of it. It's something that I have, I've taken, read the book, and it's funny that I have since we started this series, everything, I think maybe that's just God and maybe just pastors, everything that I've been looking at and reading and talking about has kind of filtered through this series, and it's been exciting. So I don't know if you know this, but I love books. So many books, I can't read my notes. So presently, I'm reading a book by John Mark Comer, The Ruthless Elimination of Hurry. I'm currently reading right now Clean Up Your Mental Mess by Dr. Caroline Leaf. I am currently reading Is Atheism Dead by Eric Metaxas. I just finished reading a trilogy, In the Kingdom of All Tomorrow by Lawhead. That's fiction. I just finished reading biography of C.S. Lewis by Alistair McGrath. And what else here? What we got here? Oh, Expository Exaltation by John Piper. And, oh, this one was my night read. Chasing the Dragon by Jackie Pullinger. And about a missionary in China. That was last month. Or current. I love to read. And in this day and age, there are so many options for people to get good information through the written word. You can read it, if you are that kind of person, ew, on something like this. No, I do that too. I use every form. You can use it on your tablet. You don't have to, if you don't have library space, you can have a library on your tablet. You can have an Audible account or listen to audiobooks, which I do constantly. And then you could do, I don't know, a paper book. I know that's really old school, but I have a library at home that I just love to fill. It's a hobby. It's my hobby. Reading is my hobby. And if you knew me when I was a youngin', this is the most unlikely hobby that I would have. Yes, I had a learning disability. Reading disability, and reading was very hard for me. So now, when I read a book, I still read slowly. Okay, I read slowly. My wife can read like a book in like a day, and even faster than her is my daughter. She can read a book. She's like, I read 4 books before I got up from bed this morning. But did you even read them? Oh yeah. Sometimes I'll quiz her, and she'll know all the answers. Like, you're sick. But I love to read. I read slow. So because of that disability that I had growing up, every book to me is precious. And every book finds a special place on the bookshelf. So I just want to talk today about reading. It's like kind of like a lost art. You're like, Pastor, really? You're going to talk about reading on church? I don't have time to read. Anybody remember Reading Rainbow? Reading Rainbow? The guy Geordi from Star Trek, remember? Was the guy ever? It was all about sparking interest in kids about the spectrum of different types of books that they could read. About sparking interest in reading. And I want to start the sermon out today. That's what the title of the sermon is, Reading Rainbow. But I want to give you this statement, right? Garbage in, garbage out. Garbage in, garbage out. Oscar Wilde said, you are what you read. So that fits with the wisdom pyramid pretty well, right? Because the statement we all eat, right? You are what you read. So if you're not reading anything, then... And depending on what you're reading... Interesting. Can you remember your favorite book as you were a child? Just think back. It took Lisa a couple seconds to ask her this question. What was your favorite childhood book? Anybody got one? What was your favorite childhood book? Why? Good, good answer. Anybody else? Yes. What's your favorite? Well, you're a child. Doesn't count. Okay. No, what is your favorite book right now? Interesting. Why?
It's like kind of interesting, and it's like kind of like it's a lot of fun.
Okay, fun. That's a good reason to read. Perfect. Anybody else who's older than how old are you?
13.
Okay, older than 13. Anybody remember their childhood book that they just loved? Yes, Gina.
Black Beauty.
Black Beauty. Why did you like that book? You love animals. Well, that's a good one. Deb.
Love The Secret Garden. The Secret Garden.
Why did you love that?
Uh-huh. And I liked the adventure of getting into the garden, and I loved how at the end the little boy was healed, and his father was finally able to accept him.
Well, if you haven't read The Secret Garden, you don't need to read it anymore. spoiler alert. Okay, good. A lot more detail than just that. Oh, she worked it. I'm in the middle of reading it right now. No. Anybody else? Got it? Yes. Little House in the Prairie. That's like a boat of books, right? Yeah. Why? Like the lifestyle, yeah. Yeah, that's cool. How old are you? Don't tell. Dr. Seuss. He's been canceled, but we're going to bring him back. Yeah. Actually, Joanne, on that note, my favorite childhood book was Yertle the Turtle. This is about all I could handle as a child. Yertle the Turtle. I read this book. I love this book. And the turtles, first off. And they stacked them. And Yertle sat on top of them. And then one of them, well, I don't know if I want to spoil it for you. You haven't read it? You can borrow my copy, okay? I read it as a child, and I loved it. I didn't realize how many socio-political analogies there are in allegory is in Yertle the Turtle. How little old Mac shook the throne of the king. I was like, whoa. Now I read it, I'm like, man, this guy was hooked up. So, all right. So reading, it's something that is important to us. We need to be lifelong learners. And you may say, I don't have time to read. I'm going to assert to you today that if you don't have time to read, you're too busy. You might, it's not something that you should throw out. Well, I'm just too busy to read. I don't have time to read. If you don't have time to sit and read something for a little while to nourish your soul, then maybe you're too busy. Just a thought. And we are very busy in America. We fill every moment. Scott on staff, I had to ask my other staff members, I was saying, now that I have like extra 12 hours, that I don't have to do the worship stuff, what should I do with it? Because I know that I'm going to fill it. I'm like, what kind of thing do you think would be more productive for me to tackle than to, because I'll fill it. I'll fill the time. And the loving lady said, you probably should read a book. I'm like, yeah, I like you guys. Do some study. You know, they helped me to kind of prioritize, because I don't want to just be like frivolous with that time. You know. McCracken talks about the importance of books in his childhood. He claims that one of the reasons he loves to pursue wisdom is that his parents instilled a love for reading in him at an early age. It's never been harder for parents to instill a love of reading in children than right now. Amen. It's really a priority issue that goes into a lot of different places. You know, there might need to be times when there are, you know, blackout zones to the internet usage or game usage or whatever, TV usage. It's very important that we teach our kids and model for our kids that, I'm going to push this over because I'm going to fall. Mm-hmm. And then Ed would have to edit it out. Where'd he go? He claims that one of the reasons he loves to pursue wisdom is because his parents did that. You might need to prioritize reading. And just say, like, yeah, you may not like it right now, but just take 10 minutes and read for a little while. And what I found is this. There are so many good books out there. If you find a book that your kid enjoys, it'll be much more than just like shoving, you know, the dictionary at them. Here, read this for 10 minutes. Even better yet, if they don't love reading, instill the love of reading in them by reading to them. If you don't have time to read to your kids, I know you're too busy. Okay? Our modern technology age invites us into a world of quickly accessed information. We jump from topic to another without slowing down to contemplate what we are learning. McCracken argues that books sharpen the way we think by challenging us to consider and argue, challenged us to consider, to argue, to struggle with the content and weigh its merits. There are books out there that are good. There are books out there that are not so good. There are books out there that are Christian, and there are books out there that are secular. And we need to be able to weigh. If you are a person who just reads and agrees with everything you read, that's not good either. All right, the big idea of this message is this. We're not even getting to the big idea yet. Paul committed his whole life to studying so that he could share the gospel. This included the study of both scripture and other writings. We know that there's many ways to consume literature. 2 Timothy 2, 4 through 9 says this. This is Paul speaking. He says this. It's kind of a funny thing to put into a gospel. But like, hey, grab my stuff. Make every effort to come to us soon, because Demas has deserted me since he loved the present world and has gone to Thessalonica. Crescent has sent has gone to Galatia, Titus to Dalmatia. He liked dogs. Only Luke is with me. Bring Mark with you, for he is useful to me in the ministry. I have sent Tychicus to Ephesus. When you come, bring the cloak I left. This is like a shopping list. It's like Walmart pickup. With Carpus. As well as the scrolls, especially the parchments. I love those parchments. Bring me scrolls and parchments. Something to read and something to write on. I miss those. Bring them to me. I want to study. Books help sharpen our minds and increase our knowledge. In 2 Timothy 4:13, Paul asked Timothy to bring the books to him when he comes. Paul is one of the most brilliant New Testament authors of all time. He wrote most of the New Testament. And you think that he was just some dim guy who had no knowledge of what was going on in the world? No. He was actually able to tackle what was going on in the world, in the culture that he lived in, because he was well-versed in the culture. He knew what was going on. He had an insatiable desire to know God, and one of the ways he grew to know God better was through reading and studying through books. McCracken suggests that books, in addition to the Bible, remember the foundation here? Always remember the foundation. If your book reading is getting out of whack with your Bible reading, think about it. Balance and boundaries are good. In addition to the Bible, fill important places in our information diet. They help us to slow down and think because they require a different set of skills. It's not thrown at us, it's dug into. We cannot approach books in the same way as a blog or an article or social media post. We must slow down and contemplate the point they present. Reading books help us make better sense of the world by challenging us to see things from different perspectives and bring clarity to issues we previously found confusing. As Christians, we must always seek to develop a better understanding of the world and the people around us. This will help us to be more faithful and effective servants of God. So let me ask you a question. Should we read secular books? It's a good question. Now, I showed you a bunch of books here. One that's left in the ground is a fictional book. Fictional book written by a Christian author, actually. But in that book, it's not a Bible story. It's just another story, but it's clean. Right? Good. C.S. Lewis, not written by a Christian author that I know of. Didn't say anything about it, but it's an autobiography of a guy who is Christian. John Piper, questionable. No, I'm just kidding. John Piper. That book is just about preaching, how to be a better preacher. You're like, yeah, he needs that. This is about a missionary. This is by a pastor, John Mark Comer. This is by a doctor. This is a secular book. This is not a Christian book. But the topic is super intriguing to me. And this is by Metaxas, which is a Christian. But he's writing about Christian things and design and all this thing, but he's not being overtly Christian. But what I'm trying to say is this. Most of those books have a bend to them, but some of them don't. By reading mostly good things, or not, I should say sacred things, it helps us to contextualize the non-sacred, the secular stuff in good ways, okay? The Bible teaches us that we should meditate on the Word of God. That's what we should be meditating on. It also teaches in Philippians 4:8, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is commendable, if there be any excellence, if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. In other words, the books that encourage us to see the goodness of God and His creation can be helpful in our walk with Christ. Books are helpful for many particular areas of life. Think about it. You want to learn a new language? Read a book on how to do that, right? You could do that. Medical information. You remember the day when you actually had to go to a library? Remember that? Some of you guys, like some of the younger ones, like, nope. Isn't that called Google now? WebMD. I love WebMD just for the laughs. Because, I mean, you could have a sniffle. You go to WebMD, I got this sniffle. They're like, oh man, you could have this, or you could die. They end every diagnosis with, and you might die. And then they say, seek medical professionals. What did I come to you for? I got hay fever. You might die. Just got to get out there so they don't get sued, right? Because there will be one guy in all of creation who died of hay fever, and the family will sue at WebMD. But so books help with that. Car repairs. I don't do that. There's no books in my library about car repairs. I can just tell you that right now. That's where I seek expertise. Or just call John. Hey, John, I got this. Well, you need to do this. Now I'm going to go somewhere else. Anyway. Information we need about daily living can be found in books, such as cookbooks. You're like, why are you talking to me about books? I'm talking to you about books because of this, because it's part of your mental diet. And I'm telling you, reading stimulates the entire body. Language is a vitally important thing that God gave us as humans that extend the image of God. above all other creations, language is vitally important for disseminating information, for understanding what the world we're in. And I think we do too much absorbing and not enough excavating. We need to be people who are stimulating our minds. Netflix doesn't count. Let me ask you a question. Somebody said this to me the other day. Who is your dead mentor? Who is your dead mentor? The only way you can learn from somebody from the past, their wisdom, their knowledge, is to read what they wrote. Everybody should have a mentor, I believe. And that mentor can be somebody physical. That should be somebody somebody you have coffee with, somebody you talk with. But I have like 100 dead mentors. I have a president as my mentor. Did you know that? Ha ha. You can too. I have Abraham Lincoln as one of my mentors. Did you know that? I read just about every book I can get my hand on that was about Abraham Lincoln. I love that guy. We've had coffee together many times. I'm not joking. I have a spot in my room, in my house, where I do my reading a lot of times. And it's I got a permanent little place to put my coffee, because that's how we read. And I get information from him about how to lead through difficult situations. I mean, how much greater of a mentor can you get about how to lead through difficult situations than Abraham Lincoln? So it's vitally important. Books allow us to be counseled and mentored by some of the greatest minds of all time from beyond the grave. Because they are from another time, dead mentors help us to see beyond the buzz, to see beyond what's going on right now, the craziness, the frenzy. And don't you find out from dead mentors? That there's nothing new under the sun. There's really nothing new. It's the same old stuff. It's just repackaged in a different way. We're dealing with the same old problems of sin that we've been dealing with since the dawn of time. Right? It's just repackaged in another form. It's more shiny maybe and quicker, definitely quicker. But dead mentors help us to see that we're all connected. Nothing really changes. And helps us to deal with what we got in front of us. Now, fiction. Fiction is useful for both learning and enjoyment. I was asking my daughter the other day, what is your favorite type of genre of literature? And she said, and she made me the proudest dad ever. She said, historical fiction. I'm like, oh, that's my girl. That's my girl. I love historical fiction. But the idea is that you can learn things about a culture through a historically fictional book. You can learn things about. And it's also just enjoyable. Enjoy your life. How many times the pastor said that to you? Enjoy your life. God has given you so many wonderful things. Language is just one of them for you to enjoy. It's not supposed to be all bad. If your life is all bad, we need to have coffee. I'll introduce you to one of my dead mentors. As long as books do not go against biblical standards of morality, they can be tremendously edifying. Colossians 10:30 says, whatever you do, do all to the glory of God. Whatever is very broad. Actually, preceding that, because when you eat or drink, that's pretty mundane. I mean, that's basically the basic elements of life, eating and drinking, right? Enjoy them. Do them for the glory of God. If you can read a fictional book and God can receive glory, then man, that's a great thing. Of course, there are some books, okay, that Christians should not read. certainly books that have that call evil good and good evil. Isaiah 52, I mean, that should be avoided. Also books that, with gratuitous descriptions of immorality or bloodshed, are not worthwhile, especially if they are pornographic in nature. I won't step on anybody's toes, but be careful. That's a good way to, you know, well, I'm not into pornography. I just read 50 Shades of Grey. It's a book. It's culture. No, it's not. No, it's not. Okay? Just be careful. Be discerning. Have discernment. If you can come out of that edified and glorifying God out of that read, then there's a good chance it's good. But if you feel a little bit dirty after, I would probably shred that book. Such books like that are part of the unfruitful works of darkness, according to Ephesians 5:11, which Paul calls shameful. Ephesians 5:12. So we got to be careful. We got to be discerning in what we, in everything. Garbage in, garbage out. This whole diet. If you put good stuff in, you're going to get good stuff out. You put garbage in, you're going to get garbage out. You are what you consume. You are what you read. You are what you consume. Okay? But it's vitally important. Finally, some books can help us better understand and reach out to those who don't know Christ. And I think that's the greatest source of language, the use of language, to better understand people, cultures, things that are going on in our world that help us better to share through language the gospel of Jesus Christ. I read a study the other day that was talking about how young people in our culture, they're finding it that they're having a really hard time communicating, using language. They don't talk to one another anymore. And because they're not reading, because they're so, they're into the pop culture. Pop culture does not usually expand your vocabulary. I mean, it's called pop. Pretty much, you're going to get three letters out of it, right? I mean, it doesn't expand your mind, it doesn't expand your vocabulary. So what's happening is students, not all students, but many students are having a hard time, even when they do engage with adults or with other students, they don't have a vocabulary that causes there to be any stimulation to the conversation. So what they do is they answer you with one-word answers. Can any mom and dad relate to that? If my kids do that, I'm like, you need to expand on that. You know, so how was your day? Good. You fail. How was your day? Expand upon that. Flesh that out for me. Oh, well, we did this and that. And then we get a conversation going. Reading and consuming good literature will expand your vocabulary, and it actually helps you, your mind, to be able to figure out, your mind learns how to figure out how a conversation is supposed to happen. Here's a heads up for any of you. Ready? Especially if you're an introvert, this is just helpful. If somebody asks you a question, it's called vocabulary, it's called conversational ping pong. Don't answer the question and then look at your phone. If that person's asking you a question, they want to have a conversation. So what you do is you work your brain so hard and you come up with something that you can ask them back. That's how conversation works. And it sounds so dumb for me to say that from the pulpit, but I'm telling you, I've had so many one-sided conversations with people where I'm trying to get to know them, and either maybe they just don't want to get to know me. They're like, yeah, we're not into talking to you. But I'll ask them the question, and they'll go, yeah, that's good. I like that. I'm going to tell a story. I had a moment of weakness one time. And you have to forgive me. I was about 10 years younger. much more mature now. It's when I was teaching, and one of my students did something stupid, as students will do from time to time, and I had to scold him. And I said, I was talking to him. His name was Harrison, and I was talking to Harrison, and I was like, but you can't do that. That's, you know, whatever, blah, blah, whatever. I can't even remember the conversation about because it's been the amount of rage canceled out all the conversation before this point. Because as I was talking to him, he pulled his phone out and started texting somebody. Oh, no, you didn't. So in a fit of blood-curdling rage, I felt like the Hulk for just a split second. I grabbed his phone and I tossed it against the wall. I didn't think I threw it that hard. And it broke in like 3 pieces. So if you think you want to text, don't do it. Take it as a warning. It's just a reflex. I can't help it. I bought him a new phone, and I apologized to him and his mom, and I did the whole thing. Yeah. Got a better phone out of the deal. If you want a better phone, come and text in front of me. Yes! Conversation. It's so vitally important to civilization, to thriving, and we need to know how to do it! And we're losing. We are losing that because we have limitations on how many characters you can use in a tweet, and your text messages are LOL. There's abbreviations in text. I don't even know what they're talking about. I'm old. So the best use of books is to increase our vocabulary so that we and understanding of our culture and our times and our world, so that we can spread the gospel. The gospel is clear. We are called to make disciples of all nations, Matthew 28. Books help in the cause because they include biographies, learning about people, cultural analysis, learning about places, and history. Understanding the people who have come before us, as well as the historical, political, and cultural settings, can open the door to a present contextualization of people groups, times, issues. I'm so tired of news headlines. They're incendiary. They're just there to get you angry. Nobody is actually looking about what's going on underneath the surface. You know what I hate? I shouldn't say I hate. I love it, but it's funny. It's something to watch out for, because they'll have a news headline, and then when you actually read the article, it has nothing to do with that news. I mean, just loosely, it's just to grab your attention. We don't look behind under the surface. We've had a year of racial tension. Year of racial tension that has exploded. But it's not done in a vacuum. There's issues and stuff that go on underneath the surface. We're not even looking at it. We're just looking at the surface. We just want to clean it up now. We don't want to talk about it. We don't want to look at it. Listen, there's stuff that's going on, and it's deeper than just a headline that we should try to understand. We should try to contextualize. We should try to heal. But we don't want it. We're gonna make two camps, for and against. That's stupid. We need to be people who are nuanced in our ability to talk to people. I had a pastor friend of mine who was a black gentleman, and I asked him a bunch of questions. He's like, he said to me, you know, in this whole year, no other pastor has asked me those questions. I think that's a problem, honestly. I think that's a problem. If we're afraid to talk to one another because we don't have the vocabulary to do it or the nerve to do it, I want to know. I want to know. I want to be able to talk to anybody. We have to understand one another. It's more than just skin deep. Remember Winston Churchill said, those who fail to learn from history are condemned to repeat it. Books also give us a window into the minds of those outside our own context to give us an ability to understand and communicate in a meaningful way. I find that very important because, think about it for a second. There's church culture, and then there's outside church culture. And I'm just going to tell you, I've been in church culture since I was knee-high to a grasshopper. I mean, they gave birth to me and brought me to church. I've been in that. So for me to understand how other people see the church, I need to research. I need to study. I need to know. Because I don't want the culture of the church, and I'm not talking about the Bible and Jesus, I'm talking about how we do things, way we say things. You know how confusing it is to people who come in and are like, I have no idea what they were talking about. We have our own emojis. I call it Christianese. We have our own way of saying things that freak people out. Paul addressed this in such an amazing way. Acts 17. This is the main text today. Acts 17, verse 16 through 24. And he was so good at this. 16 through 24. He's in Athens, the seat of secular culture of the time, right? It says that these people were constantly trying to learn the newest thing. Kind of sounds familiar, doesn't it? Like the seat of Western culture in that day. So Paul is now trying to communicate the gospel to them. Here we go. Verse 16. While Paul was waiting for them in Athens, he was deeply distressed when he saw that the city was full of idols. So he reasoned in the synagogue with the Jews and with those who worship God, as well as in the marketplace. Every day with those who happened to be there. Well, I kind of like the fact that we're in the marketplace. We're in a mall. I think that's pretty cool. Obviously, we're obeying the Bible. So every church should be in a mall, apparently. Some of the Epicureans and the Stoic philosophers also debated with him. Some said, what is this ignorant show-off trying to say? Others replied, he seems to be a preacher of foreign deities because he was telling the good news about Jesus and the resurrection. They took him and brought him to the Areopagus, that word's tough, and said, maybe learn about the new teaching you are presenting because when what you say sounds strange to us, and we want to know what these things mean. Now, the Athenians and the foreigners residing there spent their time doing nothing else but telling or hearing something new. It's like the first form of social media. All they wanted to do was just hear the newest thing. They wanted to be intrigued by the news. They wanted to debate. They wanted to, you know, put out comments in the comments section of how stupid you are for saying that thing. Paul stood in the middle of the Areopagus and said, people of Athens, I see that you are extremely religious in every respect. For as I was passing through and observing the object of your worship, I even found an altar on which was inscribed to the unknown God. They wanted to make sure they covered all their bases. They got all these gods, and if, by the way, we miss one, we'll just build an altar to him. Therefore, what you worship in ignorance, this I proclaim to you. The God who made the world and everything in it, he is the Lord of heaven and earth. Does not live in shrines made of hands, neither is he served by human hands, as though he needed anything, since he himself gives everyone life and breath and all things. From one man, he was made every nationality to live over the world, the whole world, and has determined their appointed times and the boundaries of their life. The boundaries of which they live. He did this so that they might seek God. He did these things so that they might seek God. He's building his case, right? And perhaps they might reach out and find him, though he is not far from each one of us. For in him we live and move and have our being, as even some of your own poets have said. For we are also his offspring. Paul appeals to them. He appeals to them, and he uses their own literature to make his case. Paul knows the poetry of the pagans, interestingly enough. So in Acts 17:28, it says, "For in him we live and move and exist." We have used that in churches for years. There was even an old hymn. "And we live and move and have our being in him we live." Thank God we don't sing those songs anymore. Scott, no. No. Steer clear of that song. God's like, next week, man, we're going for it. We'll add a drum solo in it and everything. It'll be awesome. We've been using that word. We've been using that phrase for years in the church. It didn't come from the Bible originally. It came from a pagan poet that Paul assimilated. The first part of 28 comes from Critica by Epimendius. I got to get these words down. I actually have it like phonetically written in my mind. And the second part of the verse from a hymn to Zeus. He borrows a hymn to Zeus, written by Salation, poet in Aratus. Say that 10 times fast. Both of these lines were directed towards Zeus in Greek literature, but Paul applied them to the creator of whom he spoke. He said, you think you got it nailed? Even your own authors have sensed this reality that God is big, God is great, God is awesome. He's set the boundaries of your life. I'm declaring to you what you think you worship in ignorance, I'm going to make clear to you. It's the God of creation, not Zeus. Not some unknown God, an altar we don't know anything about. The unknown God that you are neglecting to worship is the God of the universe. McCracken argues that any book that pursues truth could be advantageous to a Christian. He writes, if God created the world, and if he's the source and standard of truth, then all truth is his. So though Paul sometimes appealed to other writers when communicating Christ to others, his major basis was the foundational word of God. I often give you stories and analogies and tidbits from books that I've read. But we can't base sermons on man's wisdom, right? They can only be supplementary to the timeless wisdom of God. So though they are an important part of your wisdom diet, everything that you read should be filtered through this. Through this. But what we've done in our culture so much in churches that we've demonized anything outside of this. And I don't think that's fair. I think that shrinks our world too much. God has made an amazing world. He's given people amazing brains. He's given people a artistic bend that show the glory of God. He's given people a way of saying things that I could never have fabricated in my own. He's given people exceedingly great gifts. And we're all different. And we use those gifts to build up the body. And we use those gifts to present the glory of God to the world. We can use the secular to glorify God. That's a weird statement. But I would say, understand that all life is sacred. The Jewish teachers didn't have a difference between spiritual life and secular life. Did you know that? There's no such thing as spiritual life in Jewish teaching. All things were spiritual. Everything. Anything you do, whether you eat or drink, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus. Filter everything through the Word of God and His objective truth, but allow your mind to be expanded and built up by the varied gifts of His wonderful creation. This is not a profound word today. It's just a helpful thing. We're moving up, you know, we're moving up the pyramid. I think if I had built this book, I probably would have built the pyramid upside down. Because then you want to end with the Bible and like, the Bible! But we're going to end with like the smallest thing. So next week, two weeks now, the sermon's going to be like 5 minutes long. Let me pray for you. We can go for a walk in the nature. Yeah, Lord, thank you for this day, that we can just come together and study something that edifies us. Lord, I pray that you would help my brothers and sisters in this place to take a sober look at their life and just maybe assess if maybe they're too busy. Maybe there's things in their life that are taking up their time that is not edifying. We all have the same amount of time in the day. It's just a matter of how well we use that time. So God, I pray that they would find time to edify their souls and their minds by looking at good things that are going to feed them. The good, because garbage in, garbage out, but good things in, good things out. Lord, I pray that we would be discerning people, that we'd be able to look at the information that's around us and be able to filter it properly through the Word of God. Lord, we know when you were tested, the way you combated the enemy was by giving him the Word. So God, help us to be able to filter our influences, this thing that bombard us with the Word of God. Lord, we give you praise for all the varied gifts and abilities. Lord, I just want to say something simple. Lord, thank you for language. Lord, thank you for language. Thank you for the written word that allows us to expand on the creation that you've given us. Allows us to categorize and fit things and make things and create things like you do, Lord. That's part of the image of God that you put in us. So thank you for that. Help us to use it to edify ourselves, one another, and to spread the gospel to the world. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. Go read a book. God bless you.